my group for giving me this opportunity to join your web lectures. So a very good morning to all of you, and most of you would have had lectures by cardiologists, cardiac surgeons, etc. But I am a cardiac pathologist, and I propose to take you through a series of congenital cardiac anomalies over the course of the next few months. But before that, we have to understand the normal cardiac anatomy, particularly in relation to some of the significant features in congenital heart disease. Now, most of the photographs that you would be seeing in this presentation are photographs taken from specimens which we have collated at the SAGES Medical College in the cardiovascular section over a period of many years. And these are, of course, autopsy specimens. Now, very briefly, when we do autopsies in cardiac deaths, particularly when we know that we may expect a congenital anomalies, there are a few factors which we have to keep in mind while doing the autopsy. One is to look for other congenital anomalies. In situ examination of the thoracic and abdominal viscera is very important. Particularly, look at the spleen, the position of the spleen, whether there is multiple spleens or there is no spleen. And also examine the connection of pulmonary veins to the lungs, as well as the presence of the superior vena cava, whether it is unilateral, bilateral, and so on. Of course, clinical history is very important. Generally, we receive the heart and lung specimens as a block. After initial dissection, it is fixed. And then after making sure that the venous connections are normal, the lungs are separated from the heart. Now we will go on to examination of the heart. Now this is, of course, an adult heart, and this is the way the heart would be positioned in the thoracic cavity, with the apex pointing to the left. Much of the anterior surface of the heart is formed by the right ventricle and left ventricle. Particularly, 2/3 is formed by the right ventricle and 1/3 by the left ventricle. The large vessel here that you may see coursing along the epicardial fat towards the apex is the left anterior descending coronary artery, and it indicates the position of the interventricular septum. Therefore, you know that this is all right ventricle and this is all left ventricle. So 2/3 of the anterior surface of the heart is formed by right ventricle and 1/3 by the left ventricle. Then you will notice two great vessels arising from the base of the heart. The pulmonary artery is anterior and to the left. The aorta is posterior and to the right. And kind of encircling the two great vessels are the atrial appendages. This is how we pathologists would love to look at a heart, not in the normal thoracic position. But here you see a good amount of the descending and thoracic aorta. Now this is a superior view of the base of the heart. And you will see again the main pulmonary artery with its valves placed anteriorly, superiorly, and to the left. The aorta is wedged between both the atrial chambers and the atrial appendages, posterior and to the right. The left atrium is the most posterior chamber. These are the pulmonary veins which we have cut. And this large vessel that you see opening into the right atrium is the right SVC. And when we describe the anatomy of the heart, we generally go along the flow of the blood from the right atrium to the pulmonary artery, left atrium, left side of the heart to the aorta. And that is the way in which I will be describing the heart. Now first we look at the atria. Now, how do we decide that this is the right atrium and the left-sided one is the left atrium? Not because they are placed on the right side or on the left side, not because it receives the superior vena cava or the pulmonary veins, because all of you will be aware that in congenital heart diseases, these can be variously changed. So how do we identify the right and the left atrium? We identify the right and the left atrium based on their morphology of their atrial appendage. Now this is the right atrial appendage. You will see that it is triangular in shape. It has a broad neck by which it communicates with the main atrial chamber. In contrast, the left atrial appendage is long, narrow, has got multiple hooklets or crevices like this, and it has a narrow neck by which it communicates with the main left atrial chamber. So this is the way in which we identify the right and the left atrium, not based on their position, not based on their venous connections. So here we have the morphological right atrium with the right atrial appendage, the morphological left atrium with the left atrial appendage on the left side. Likewise, how do we identify the ventricles? Again, not because a right-sided ventricle is right ventricle or the left-sided ventricle is left ventricle, no. The right ventricle has a thin, compact portion which may, of course, vary in thickness. But what is very striking is that the right ventricular chamber is heavily and coarsely trabeculated. Even the septal surface is heavily trabeculated. So right throughout the chamber, you will have heavy, coarse, large, prominent trabeculations. In contrast, if you see the left ventricle opened out, you will see a thicker, compact portion. The trabeculations are mainly to the apical part, and they are much finer and more delicate. But what is more important is the septal surface. The septal surface in the left ventricle is always smooth. This is part of the interventricular septum. On the left side, it is always smooth. On the right side, it is heavily trabeculated. So this is how we identify a morphological right ventricle and a morphological left ventricle. Now, when we open the heart, we generally start with the right atrium, and we make an opening connecting the IVC to the right atrial appendage. So our first cut is like this. Superiorly, you have the SVC opening, and at the junction of the SVC opening, with the right atrial roof, you will have a groove which is known as the sulcus terminalis, and this groove is important because it contains the SA node. So here we have opened up the right atrial chamber, and there are very important landmarks that you have to identify. One is the right atrium consists of a smooth sinus venarum and a trabeculated portion which is part of the atrial appendage. Separating the trabeculated part from the smooth part is a circular ridge of muscle, which is the crista terminalis. And arising from this are like parallel groups of muscle fibers. These are known as the pectinate muscles, almost like a comb-like pattern. The crista terminalis forms the posterior and lateral border of the smooth sinus venarum. In the roof, superiorly, we have the opening of the SVC. And inferiorly, somewhere here, we have the opening of the IVC. So a closer look at the right atrium. some very important landmarks is this is the opening of the SVC, and this oval area that you see here is the fossa ovalis. The floor of the fossa ovalis is actually the septum primum, the main part of the interatrial septum. So this will form the interatrial septum. And around this fossa ovalis, you find a ridge of muscle. This is the limbus of the fossa ovalis. Now, this muscle mass, which separates the superior part of the limbus of the fossa ovalis from the SVC, is nothing but an infolding of the atrial musculature between the SVC and the right superior pulmonary veins. And along with this infolding, it will also carry some amount of the epicardial fatty tissue. So, beneath the fossa ovalis, you will find the opening of the coronary sinus. Separating the fossa ovalis from the coronary sinus, you will see a ridge of muscle. This is known as the sinus septum. The IVC opening is somewhere here, and guarding the sinus IVC opening is a thin bit of valvular tissue, which is known as the Eustachian valve. It is generally a very inconspicuous little bit of delicate valvular tissue, but sometimes you can have bridges of valvular tissue extending from the IVC all the way up to the SVC, forming a fine filigree network, which is known as the Chiari's network. The anteroinferior part of the limbus of the fossa ovalis, there may be a mound which corresponds to the aortic root. So this is the area, again, one would have to be careful when one is using a device to close the defects in the interatrial septum, or to gain access from the through the interatrial septum into the left atrium. Now, so this is the sinus septum, and it contains the tendon of Todaro. Beneath the sinus septum, this opening that you see inferior to the sinus septum is the opening of the coronary sinus, guarded by the Thebesian valve. So this is just to give you the appearance of the interatrial septum. It is, we have translucently illuminated it. This is from the left side. From the right side, sometimes you do get interatrial septum actually is a flat valve-like structure which closes once the lungs expand, because the left atrial pressure will be more than the right atrial pressure. But sometimes a small propatent defect may be present, as you can see here. Now, this is again opened up right atrium and the left atrium. This is the vestibule. Vestibule is that part which forms the muscular tissue just above the corresponding atrioventricular valves. Much of the interatrial septum has been removed, but you can see the epicardial fat going down from the roof into the interatrial septum to a little extent. And what is more important are these landmarks. So here we have the sinus septum, Eustachian valves. This is the opening of the coronary sinus, guarded by the Thebesian valve. Now, if one draws a line along the tricuspid annulus and extends part of the sinus septum down here, it will meet at an apex. It forms a triangle, which is known as the triangle of Koch. And at the apex is the AV node. And within this, you will have the tendon of Todaro. So this is a representation of the same. So here, the fossa ovalis, the limbus of the fossa ovalis, the sinus septum, the coronary sinus with part of the Thebesian valve, tricuspid valve. Here we have drawn a line along the annulus, and another line extending from the sinus septum right here. So here somewhere we will get the AV node, and this triangle is known as the triangle of Koch. Now, since we are talking of interatrial septum, a brief word on the interventricular septum. The interventricular septum is muscular and membranous. And this is just to show you the membranous septum, which again has been transilluminated. So on the left side, the membranous septum is largely beneath the right coronary cusp. We will look at it in more detail later on. And what is important here on the right side is that the tricuspid annulus kind of crosses over this membranous septum. So the membranous septum has an interatrial and an interventricular component. So after finishing the landmarks in the right atrium, we come to the tricuspid valve. The tricuspid valve, as the name suggests, consists of three leaflets. Here we have the anterior tricuspid leaflet, the septal tricuspid leaflet, and the posterior tricuspid leaflet. The anterior tricuspid leaflet is the larger of the leaflet, and it has a prominent belly of papillary muscles, the anterior papillary muscle. This is the only papillary muscle tricuspid leaflet and the posterior tricuspid leaflet. Now, the anterior tricuspid leaflet is attached by a prominent belly of papillary muscle, which is the anterior papillary muscle, and at the base of that you have the moderator band. This is only the constant main papillary muscle in the right ventricle. This is the septal tricuspid leaflet. And beneath that, you will have the membranous septum. Attached to the septal tricuspid leaflet is the small belly of papillary muscle. This is the medial papillary muscle, which is of importance. Then the posterior tricuspid leaflet has numerous chordae. Has numerous chordae, which are tethered to the right ventricle. When we look at the ventricles, we describe the ventricles as three segments, the inlet segment, the trabecular segment, and the outlet septum. So when we look at the right ventricle, this is the inlet portion extending from the tricuspid annulus till the attachment of the trabeculate. Then we have the attachment of the chordae, From here to the apex is the trabeculated portion, and then we have the outlet portion. It is the outlet portion of the right ventricle which is important. This is the anterior papillary muscle, at the base of which I told you, you have the moderator band. From here going up to the pulmonary valve is a prominent muscle band, which is known as the trabeculoseptomarginalis. and this muscle mass divides into a posterior limb and an anterior limb. And in the crest of the Y, you have a muscle here, which is known as the supraventricular crest or crista supraventricularis. Now, this muscle mass, which separates the pulmonary valve from the tricuspid valve, is the ventriculo-infundibular cord. And this large mass of muscle, which connects it to the anterior free wall of the right ventricle, is the parietal wall. So these are the important landmarks in the right ventricle: trabecular septomarginalis, the posterior limb, the anterior limb, the parietal band, the ventriculo-infundibular fold. All this forms the right ventricular outflow or the outlet septum. The pulmonary valve has three cusps: two posterior, which face the two anterior aortic cusps, and this is the anterior pulmonary valve cusp. Then we have the main pulmonary artery, which divides into right and left limbs. Now, coming to the left atrium, we open the left atrium by joining the pulmonary vein. So we cut through the roof of the left atrium and open up the left atrial chamber. We opened up left atrium, and what you see is this roughened area here, which indicates the position of the interatrial septum. Over here, superiorly, we have the openings of the pulmonary veins, and here we have the opening of the atrial appendage. So, a closer look of the interatrial septum, this rough patch, the opening of the atrial appendage, and the openings of the pulmonary veins. Again, what you have seen earlier, the translucent interatrial septum. The other more important structure is the atrial appendage, to which a lot of attention is being paid. The left atrial appendage is an anterolateral structure, and it overlies the right ventricular outflow over the left main coronary artery and the left circumflex artery. And it has a narrow neck by which it communicates with the main atrial chamber. Now, this opening is variously described as being either elliptical or oval. And it can have rarely a triangular or irregular opening. This is important when you are putting in devices to block the atrial appendage. The atrial appendage has trabeculations in the pattern of a palm leaf appearance, with ridges of muscle and thin intertrabecular wall. Now, this LA appendage has various shapes, and these are also believed to be important, but most of them are radiological studies. So this is the left atrial appendage opening, the left and pulmonary veins, superior and inferior. There is a ridge of muscle which separates it from the left atrial appendage. This is the region of the fossa ovalis, and there is a thin ridge of muscle here, which is known as the vestibule, separating it from the mitral valve. These are some of the shapes of the LA that have been described. Classically, four shapes like a cactus, cauliflower, windsock appearance, but all these are imaging studies, and much of its appearance will determine upon the view of the image. So very difficult to give classify these images, but attempts have been done so. Conduction system, as I told you, we have the SA node here, where the SVC opens, joins the right atrial roof. Now, from this SA node, there are fibers going into the left atrium, which are known as the Bachmann bundles. Of course, morph
cannot make it out. The left atrium is connected to the left ventricle through the mitral valve. Mitral valve has two cusps, anterior mitral leaflet and a posterior mitral leaflet. The anterior mitral leaflet is a little large, curtain-like, and the posterior has got a narrow circumference. The posterior mitral leaflet has a narrow width and a larger circumference. There are two constant prominent papillary muscles, the anterolateral papillary muscle and the posteromedial papillary muscles. So this is a closer look at the papillary muscles and their chordae, fine delicate structures. This would be the region of the commissures, the junction between the anterior and the posterior tricuspid leaflet. And here you can see fine, delicate, fan-shaped chordae. The posteromedial papillary, anterolateral papillary muscle and the posteromedial papillary muscle. This is the ventricular aspect of the mitral valve with the two groups of papillary muscle. And what is important here to note the fibrous continuity between the posterior mitral leaflet, this is the ventricular aspect, and the aortic valve. See this fibrous continuity. Unlike the right ventricular outflow, which is totally muscular, the left ventricular outflow or infundibulum is partly muscular and partly fibrous because of this fibrous continuity. This fibrous continuity is mainly with the non-coronary cusp. Between the non-coronary and the right coronary, you will see a translucent area. This is the region of the membranous septum. Another closer look to show the fibrous continuity between the posterior part of the mitral leaflet and the aortic cusp. Note the smooth septal surface of the left ventricle. So here we have the aortic valve cusp, the non-coronary, right coronary and left coronary cusp based on the coronary arteries arising from there. This is seen from the cut portion of the aorta from the top. The three aortic cusps which are closely opposed to each other. Here we have dissected out the epicardial fat. This is the right coronary artery. And here you have the left coronary artery. This is the non-coronary cusp. And this is the way in which we cut through the various coronary arteries. We give transverse slices through this so that we can examine each and every little segment. This is the right coronary artery in the right atrioventricular group. Then we have the LAD here with all the deep cuts, and we examine each and every segment to look at the coronary ostia, whether there is a thrombus or a plaque as you see here. So this in brief completes the anatomy of the heart. I will just briefly show you some imaging planes which we have done of the heart. And most of you are familiar with these three basic images, the sagittal plane, the transverse plane and the coronal plane. So we get parasternal, apical, subcostal and suprasternal views. So this is a parasternal long axis view of the heart. We have cut the heart in that plane. Anteriorly, you will find the right ventricular outflow leading to pulmonary valve, the interventricular septum, the left ventricular outflow leading to the aortic valve, and right posteriorly, we have the left atrium. Here again, you can see the aortic mitral continuity, fibrous continuity. This is the parasternal short axis view showing the wedge position of the aorta between both the atrial appendages and the pulmonary outflow, which is anterior and superior. A short axis view again from the middle portion of the heart. This is the four chamber view, and what I want to highlight here is the apical attachment of the tricuspid valve in relation to the mitral valve here. The tricuspid valve is at a much lower segment, and here you have part of the membranous septum, and if you have a defect here, you will have a communication between the right atrium and the left ventricle, which is the Gerbody's defect. And here you can see part of the interatrial septum with the fat, and you can okay, this is a closer look of the same. And here again is a subcostal or sagittal axis, the right ventricular leading to pulmonary artery, the wedged position of the aortic valve. This would be the ventriculo-infundibular fold, part of the infundibular septum. And here you can see the aortic valve in close proximity to the interatrial septum. So if any device pierces this part, you will get into the aortic aorta. And if you go a little superiorly, you will go out of the heart into the transverse sinus. And here you can note the fat creeping down into the interatrial septum. So echo gives you a basic idea of the pathology of the heart. Now, when we are describing congenital heart diseases, it is often a little worrisome because of the nomenclature, the classification, and you feel you often need to know the embryology. But if you follow this sequential segmental analysis, it is a systematic way of describing the heart. It is logical, based on anatomic facts, and based on chamber morphology, connections, and relations. Starting with the direction of the apex of the heart. Normally, the apex of the heart is left-sided, that is levocardia. If it is to the midline, you would call it mesocardia. If it is to the right side, it is dextrocardia. As I told you, during the autopsy, we look at the thoracic and abdominal situs. If it is normal, we call it solitary. If there is inverses, for example, if the spleen is on the right side, the liver is large and midline, we would call it inverses. And if we are not sure, we will use the term ambiguous, particularly when there is asplenia or polysplenia. This is situs inversus. Here you see the stomach on the right side. This is taken posteriorly. And here again, the liver is large and midline. Apex of the heart pointing towards the right. Here, a stomach which is to the right. So this is situs inversus. This is the liver with the gallbladder towards the left side. There is no spleen, as you can see here. Polysplenia, when you have multiple spleens, as you see here. Some people use the term accessory spleen. Polysplenia, when the splenicules are distributed on both sides of the mesogastrium. Then we look at the systemic and venous connection. So here you have the left SVC opening into the left-sided atrium, the pulmonary veins joining together to form a common chamber, as you see here, which goes down, probably pierces the diaphragm. So when we look at the atria, we describe the atrial situs, then we go to the atrioventricular connections, the topology of the ventricular mass, and the ventricular arterial connection. Atrial situs can be solitus when it is normal, that is right atrium on right side, left atrium on left side. Inversus, when the morphological right atrium is on the left side, morphological left atrium is on the right side. And ambiguous or right isomerism and left isomerism. This is atrial situs solitus. Right atrial appendage on right side, left atrial appendage on the left side. Here we have juxtaposition of atrial appendages. Here we have the morphological right atrium on the left side and the morphological right atrium on the morphological left atrium on the right side. It's difficult to get both together in one picture. This is atrial situs inversus. Both the atrial appendages looking like right atrial appendages, so this is right atrial isomerism. Here, right atrial appendage on the left side, right atrial appendage on the right side. So, right isomerism. Right isomerism often goes with asplenia and abnormal pulmonary venous connection. The atrial situs often goes with the bronchial situs. In a normal heart, the right bronchus is short, divides early, and the pulmonary artery passes through them. This is an epiarterial bronchus. The left bronchus is long and divides only at the hilum, and the pulmonary artery crosses this bronchus. So this is a hyperarterial bronchus. So if you have right isomerism, both the bronchial divisions will be like the right side. It always goes hand in hand with the atrial situs. Then we come to atrioventricular junction, the type and mode. Is it concordant, discordant, ambiguous, double inlet connection, absent right or left connection? This is concordant atrioventricular junction. The right atrium leading to right ventricle, the left atrium leading to a morphological left ventricle. Now discordant, the morphological right atrium leading to a ventricle having the morphology of a left ventricle. See the smooth septal surface. This is the left atrium leading to a ventricle having features of a right ventricle. So this is atrioventricular discordance. Then what is the mode of connection? Do we have two permanent perforate valves, one patent, one imperforate, straddling and overriding valves? So these are two patent perforate valves on the right side and on the left side. We have a common AV valve here, bridging across the ventricular septum on both the right and the left side. So instead of two valves, we have a common AV valve. Now what is straddling and what is overriding? Straddling, when the tension apparatus is attached to both sides of the septum, and overriding only when the annulus is connected to both the ventricles. This is straddling of the tricuspid valve. Now this is the tricuspid valve, the interventricular septum, and you can see the chordae of the tricuspid valve crossing the interventricular septum and tethering it to the belly of the papillary muscle of the mitral valve. So this is straddling of the tricuspid valve. Now ventricles, as I've told you, we identify on the basis of trabecular pattern, septal surface, whether you have a solitary ventricle or a rudimentary ventricle, and we have to talk about looping of the ventricles, D and L loop. In the embryology, the heart is a straight tube. And normally, this, the central portion, the common ventricular chamber, bulges to the right and posteriorly. Thereby, the right ventricle is on the right side, the left ventricle is on the left side. This is known as D lobe or normally related ventricle. Here we have the bulge on the left side. So we have the morphological right ventricle on the left side, the morphological left ventricle on the right side. So this is L lobe or inverted ventricle. So D looping and L looping. So this is left ventricle, right ventricle. So this is normal looping. Here we have morphological left ventricle on the right side. And this is L looping. The morphological right ventricle on the left side. So this is L looping. Atrioventricular discordance with L looping of the ventricle. Here we have a single ventricle, maybe a small outlet chamber here. Note we find, so this is a single ventricle. Note the fine claviculation, a smooth area which is probably the septum. So this is most likely a single ventricle with left ventricular morphology. This is a small outlet chamber, and from the single ventricle you have two outflows, the aorta, and this outflow leads to the pulmonary artery. Then connection, ventriculo-arterial junction, connection of chambers to the arteries. A morphology of the outflow, relationship of arteries to one another. This is normal right ventricular outflow leading to pulmonary valve, normal left ventricular outflow leading to the aorta. Here we have a morphological left ventricle, right ventricle leading to the aorta. See, these are the aortic coronary artery. So this is the aorta with aortic arch. So this is ventriculo-arterial discordance. A morphological left ventricle, see the smooth septal surface leading to the pulmonary artery, ventriculo-arterial discordance. As you get in transposition. Two outflows. Suppose you have a single ventricle, right ventricle, with two outflows, one leading to the aorta and the other to the pulmonary artery. This is part of the infundibular septum, and you have a VSD which is, appears to be committed to the aorta. So this is double outlet right ventricle. Narrowing of the right ventricular outflow, there is marked narrowing, a small infundibular chamber, and bicuspid pulmonary valve. Again, narrowing of the os infundibulum on the right side, a small infundibular chamber, and dysplastic pulmonary valve. These are features of Fallot's tetralogy. In addition, you may get pulmonary valvar stenosis, a dome-shaped pulmonary valve with a small central orifice. Then, relationship of the great arteries. Here you have aorta to the left, pulmonary artery to the right. Aorta is to the right but anterior. Pulmonary artery is left and to the posterior. So, these kind of relationship you may get in DORV, or we can call them malposition of the great vessels depending on their connection to the ventricular chambers. Instead of two great vessels arising from the heart, we can have a common arterial trunk, as you see in truncus. So from the right ventricle, you have a large common arterial trunk. And there is a VSD here. From this common arterial trunk, you have the right and the left pulmonary artery, and the vessel continues as the arch of aorta. The coronaries are situated in the sinus. So this is truncus arteriosus, common arterial trunk. The aortic arch is generally left-sided. Sometimes you can get a right-sided aortic arch with mirror image branching. So this is how you would go about describing the heart based on the sequential segmental analysis, analyzing the atria, atrioventricular connections, ventricles, ventriculo-arterial connections, and the great vessels. So this would be the end of my talk, and thank you very much. I'm sorry for the audio problem. Thank you.